What's up, Fort Worth family? It's Fort Worth Fabian, Big Boss Fabo, back with a reaction video for the channel, man, for the family. Today, we're doing a reaction to Genesis, Behind the Music. So, this is a reaction I've been meaning to do for a while now. I actually had it like saved, and I started doing a bunch of different other VH1 Behind the Music reactions. I did Megadeth. I did more recently. I did Metallica. I've done a few, man. I got a whole VH1 Behind the Music playlist. But the more recent ones I did was Megadeth, Pantera, Metallica. I've done Guns N' Roses, but several. So be sure to check out the playlist. Like, comment, subscribe, hit the notification bell. Follow me on Instagram, Twitter, Fort Worth Fabian's, the road to a million subscribers. I got a lot of different forms of reaction content, man. Just looking to just drop content. Just drop, and see where the path takes me, man. Be sure to support a young entrepreneur. Donations are open. Link in the description down below. With that being said, man, let's go ahead and hop into the reaction. So we're doing a reaction to Genesis, Behind the Music. And I'm not really familiar with their story. So, hey, if you have additional recommendations for Behind the Music reactions you want to see, put them down in the comment section down below.
They were upper-class English schoolboys, groomed to become gentlemen.
I was banned from playing the guitar because it was a symbol of the revolution.
It wasn't the proper thing to do, but they became one of the world's biggest rock bands.
It was the most unlikely thing in the world for me ever to even to pursue this career. It was never what I was supposed to do.
Lead singer Peter Gabriel put Genesis into the art rock spotlight.
I remember coming out in this fox's head and a red dress. And that was a great way to start a show.
Soon after Genesis gained stardom, their theatrical frontman made a dramatic exit.
One day we woke up and the front page of Melody Maker was Gabriel quits Genesis.
It was a bit like telling someone decided to kill their child.
It was like Jagger leaving the Stones.
But Genesis discovered the perfect replacement was already in the band. With Phil Collins out front, Genesis rose from cult favorite to international pop phenomenon. Woo! But Phil took heat for the band's new musical direction.
He took heat for the band's new musical direction, but he pretty much launched them into international stardom. Huh? Make it make sense for me. Make it make sense.
Peter Gabriel and Phil Collins, you know, which Genesis do you prefer?
The old Genesis fans nightly stick pins in my effigy.
Then Phil Collins launched a solo career that upstaged the success of Genesis. And after 26 years with a band he helped take to the pinnacle of rock success, Phil Collins quits Genesis.
I'm not part of the story anymore. I'm part of the history, but I'm not part of the current story.
The fans wait 10 years for his triumphant return.
That boy got a voice.
Now, the story of a few well-bred English gentlemen who took a risk and rocked the world. Genesis.
Hey, what's the name of that song? Genesis Tonight? That's what I'm guessing. He said it like three times. Let me know in the comment section down below.
The story behind the music.
Remastered.
There's a lot of history, and my usual response to how I view my past with Genesis is that it was a healthy part of growing up.
We used to fight a lot in the band, really. I mean, I think it's difficult for close friends to sometimes to be in the same band.
But we never had a single argument about money. We used to argue about music.
Look at that new haircut, bro.
When one singer left for a solo career, they found another.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
When that singer also became a solo sensation, Genesis still survived. From their art rock early years to their power pop glory days, Genesis had always been able to reinvent itself and move on. But when Collins leaves in 1996, Genesis fans find it hard to accept life without him. The band's history together nearly spans a lifetime. From boyhood to adulthood, the strength of Genesis has been the friendships that formed it.
The childhood bond is between Tony and Peter. They're very close and always have been, still are.
Leaving all the world to play, they disappear.
Shy schoolboys Peter Gabriel and Tony Banks met in 1963 on their first day at one of England's elite boarding schools. The two privileged 13-year-olds attended Charterhouse, founded in 1611, an institution steeped in tradition, discipline, and strict academic standards.
It was a pretty horrible place, and at nighttime, you'd hear sounds of... boys either crying or masturbating, or a combination of both.
This fool.
And that was a sort of welcome to public school life.
Hell no.
Public school was reserved for the upper crust of English society, and Charterhouse ranked among England's most exclusive.
It was quite a stuffy public school for its period. You were very out of touch with the real world.
But just a quick train ride away in London, a musical revolution was brewing.
The Beatles were well established. It was before flower power, but I mean, London was definitely swinging. All you wanted to do was to be part of that youth culture of London, which was just so exciting.
By 1965, Anthony Phillips and Mike Rutherford had also entered Charterhouse. The two shared a passion for music and rebelling against the rules of the institution.
We definitely did feel incarcerated.
Actually, I was banned from playing the guitar most of the time I was there.
Free minds unite, you know what I'm saying? It's basically like creative minds flock. Imagine being in an institution. That's kind of like an institution, so to speak. You know what I mean? Maybe it's not your preferences in terms of your passions, your creative pursuits. You're just attending a school. Maybe your parents are just paying for it. But you're able to run into like-minded folk and collaborate on ideas.
Because it was a symbol of the revolution. Quite early on, we got into writing our own songs. And to be honest, I mean, I'd say that the Ant was probably the... Anthony Phillips, the leading driving force at Charterhouse.
When Mike and Anthony planned to record a demo tape of their songs, Peter and Tony, who had also been writing songs and playing in a band together, volunteered to help.
I said to him, actually, why don't we come along? I'll come along and play keyboards on it. And Peter will come along and play drums. When Ant started singing his song, I thought, well, Peter's got a much better voice than that. Why don't you let Peter sing all the songs, you know?
Peter Gabriel stepped out from behind his drum kit to sing lead vocals.
Tell you the story of how my life ran.
The boys gave their demo to Jonathan King, a Charterhouse graduate with music industry experience.
I think he heard something on it. I think it was probably Peter's voice that he liked.
The four 16-year-old songwriters were still in school in January of 67 when Jonathan King signed them to a songwriting deal. Later that year, the boys were still at Charterhouse when they got signed to Decca Records.
And we were like sort of part-time school kids. We hadn't really gone serious.
Genesis released their debut single, The Silent Sun, in February of 1968.
See, it's such a pattern back then. I'm not sure if it was just the era or the I don't know what it was. But a lot of these young artists got involved in the music pursuits fairly early. And then they end up just coming across some type of manager, you know, talent agent that just puts them in a position to get a deal or get exposure. If you hear like various different stories about how a lot of these bands fell into their deals, they just got together and played, and a lot of it's live performance as well, you know, events, networking. But I don't know. I really salute and commend a lot of the, I guess the, I would say just the passion behind being able to come up with these ideas and get together and actually pursue things so early, man. You see kids nowadays, maybe they're not always encouraged to pursue what they want to do, but ideally there's a lot of examples of what happens when the youth fully embrace their passion without naysayers, negativity, you know, like people hating on a dream. So that's all I'm really trying to convey, but it's interesting to see that a lot of the bands, they came together fairly early, got deals super early. I think I was looking into Pantera, the Pantera VH1 documentary. If I remember correctly, they had a similar situation, something like that. Just coming together fairly early as jits.
Peter Gabriel was just 18 years old.
The silence and it never shines. She is the warmth of my lonely heart.
But DJs didn't spin the Silent Sun. Undaunted, the boys spent their summer holiday in a recording studio and produced their first album.
The album was released to a blaze of obscurity.
Released in the spring of 69, From Genesis to Revelation sold little more than 600 copies.
And of course, the pound note signs weren't flashing.
In midsummer, Peter, Tony, Mike, and Anthony finished their final term at Charterhouse. For the four graduates, it was a defining moment. They could go on to college, as everyone expected, or devote themselves to the band.
We somewhat foolishly decided to choose music.
Their parents were less than thrilled.
I'm sure they thought, oh my God, please, please give him a couple of years and a grad of it, you know.
Music was there as an option, and I knew it was a chance that would only come once.
It was a chance they almost missed. With sales of their first album non-existent, Genesis was soon dropped by Decca Records.
Damn!
Then in March of 70, less than a year after their graduation from Charterhouse, the band played a showcase gig for Charisma Records, where they were seen by President Tony Stratton Smith and managing director Gail Coulson.
There were five of them on stage and six of us in the audience.
Charisma Records signed the band, but guitarist Anthony Phillips was not feeling celebratory.
I suddenly started getting hit by stage fright. It was weird. I mean, I was playing the chords and I suddenly thought, what the hell comes next? And my mind just went completely blank. I just couldn't think. And you sort of go onto autopilot, and I got through it, but it really scared me. It really scared me a lot.
His stage fright got worse as Genesis took to the road, but Phillips kept his anxiety a secret from the band.
And this went on for months. I never actually did lose it, but in the end I physically cracked. I got bronchial pneumonia.
Anthony was bedridden, and after a few weeks off, he found he was out of sync with the rest of the band.
It just felt, I don't know, I think I'd sort of lost it, really. My heart had gone out of it, really. I wasn't going through the big terrors anymore, but I suppose the dream had gone somehow, in a way.
After 4 years playing with the group he once led, Anthony Phillips quit. His former schoolmates and band members were devastated.
It was, you know, like the Musketeers, and I thought we couldn't lose one person.
And he was very important to the band in the early stages. I'd say he was almost the key member. And it, honestly, when he left, I thought we wouldn't carry on.
For the first time, Genesis would have to survive the loss of a leading member of the band. It would not be the last time. Next, Genesis a new look. By the summer of 1970, the elite young men of Genesis had only been out of school for a year, but they had already lost fellow classmate and founding member Anthony Phillips. Peter Gabriel, Mike Rutherford, and Tony Banks began the search for a guitarist to replace Ant Phillips and a new drummer. Their one ad in London's Melody Maker magazine caught the eye of a 19-year-old drummer named Phil Collins.
I was looking through the adverts and I saw Tony Stratton Smith requires drummer sensitive to acoustic music and 12-string guitar player.
Collins had gone to drama school and worked as a child actor. He had been drumming for years in various London bands when he saw the ad. That day, Collins scheduled an audition at the home of Peter Gabriel's parents.
Pulled up outside this very, very nice country house and said, oh, this is all right, you know. And Mike Rutherford walks in with carpet slippers and smoking jacket, you know, sort of dressing gown. And I thought, this is where, what planet have I landed on? Yeah.
Looking for someone.
As soon as he walked in and sat down, the members of Genesis knew Phil Collins was their man.
It's funny with the drummer, when they sit down with the kid before they even play.
So many hits and bangers, bro. Somebody do me this special favor and name drop every song as they appear throughout the documentary, man. What was the song just then?
Of Genesis knew Phil Collins was their man.
That boy got a voice on him.
When they sit down with the kid before they even play, you get a sort of vibe off them. And he was fantastic.
I thought, this is the guy.
There was no doubt in my mind, or Peter's mind, that Phil was the man.
A month after Collins joined the band, Genesis released their second album in October of 1970.
Stand up and fight, for you know we are right. We must strike at the lies that are spread like disease.
Trespass soon followed their first album, Into Obscurity, but it did help build a cult following for their live shows. That same December, Genesis found a permanent replacement for Anthony Phillips in 20-year-old guitarist Steve Hackett.
I thought they were great, but I thought there was room for improvement. So I guess I was as crazy as they were.
Genesis' classic lineup was in place, and the boys in the band took to the road.
It was great fun. And we just worked and worked and worked. We played the north of England one day, and we played the south of England the next.
By 1971, Genesis had gained the attention of London's music community and their future manager, Tony Smith.
So I was initially struck by Peter, because he was extraordinary in his, the way he looked and the way he presented himself.
With the release of Foxtrot, Genesis finally cracked the UK album charts. And in the fall of 72, with their fourth album headed into the top 20, Gabriel took the band's live act closer to the edge.
We had this album cover for Foxtrot, which had a woman in a fox's head.
And he walked one day on stage in a red dress and a fox's head.
You could tell that the majority of the audience found it very disturbing. It was a great way to start a show.
Suddenly, we had our pictures on the front of Melody Maker.
It was far easier.
Homie was bold. I'll give him that. Peter Gabriel. I don't know why. The name ring a bell, obviously, but... He had a successful solo career with Salisbury Hill as his first single. Peter Gabriel. Okay. Buddy was wild.
To put a picture of him with the flower mask on the front cover of Melody Maker, then to put a picture of the five of us who looked pretty much like any other rock group.
Genesis suddenly found themselves on the British rock A-list. And by the summer of 73, Genesis had completed their first headlining tour of Great Britain and a full tour of America.
Hey, babe, your summer's waiting for you.
But offstage, the other band members were increasingly bothered by the focus on Peter's theatrics.
If you're the front man for a band, you get to be the main spokesman, and that tends to create quite a lot of resentments.
By the time the fifth Genesis album, Selling England by the Pound, hit the U.S. charts in the fall of 73, Peter was a star, and tensions were running high within the band.
Pete's show tended to get reviewed, and the band didn't really get a review. It was very much he rather than they.
He had some costumes, you couldn't even get his microphone anywhere near his mouth. And you have to ask yourself if that wasn't perhaps going a little too far.
Yeah. I started to get a little bit frustrated that the people were coming to see what Peter was doing rather than hearing the music.
Genesis went into the studio in early 1974 to record their next album, The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway. But Peter Gabriel had a lot more than music on his mind.
My first daughter was born, and I didn't think she was going to survive for a couple of weeks, so there was nowhere else that I wanted to be but with my wife and child. They registered this more as a lack of interest and involvement in the band, and that made me quite angry at the time.
We were unsympathetic. We hadn't had kids. Looking back, I think it must have been hard for him because his life changed and ours didn't.
First to have children, first to realise there was something more to life than just being in a rock band, you know.
But we were at that point where it's the band or it's not the band.
So, yeah, that could be a tough choice to make, but salute to being able to have that reflection and look back and say, hey, you know, at that point, we was probably immature in saying that. He had a family. We didn't know what it was like to have a family, and may have been judgmental in that moment. But, yeah, I mean, they was in a moment to where they was probably really set in what they were doing, pursuing the career. They didn't want to be derailed. So maybe they saw that as a sign of, hey, you're kind of messing with the band. It's either you're with us or you're against us, but that can be a tough position to be put in.
After 9 intense years of playing in a band with his boyhood friends, Peter Gabriel wanted out.
It's a bit like telling someone you decided to kill their child. You know, it's not a good feeling.
When you decided you wanted to leave, I tried to persuade him not to, you know, definitely, because, you know, for all sorts of reasons, really. One is he was my friend, and two, I also thought I didn't know whether the band could survive without him. And now my ship is sinking.
The captain stands alone. Boy got a haircut on.
If we can out, I'm out.
When behind the music. After playing for nearly a decade in a band with his boarding school friends, 24-year-old Peter Gabriel was thinking of life beyond Genesis in the fall of 1974. After taking time off from the band to be with his newborn daughter and to work on a film project, Gabriel returned to tour with Genesis in support of The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway, the band's third top 10 album in the UK.
So Peter came back. Well, we welcomed him back, of course, but I mean, I think we knew at that point that anything could happen at any time.
That time came in the spring of 75.
I think it was like week one of the tour in America. Peter came to my room now and said he decided that really he wanted to move on and wanted to leave the band. And so my first question, facing a year of gigs in front of me, was when did he want to leave?
I agreed then to carry on doing the touring cycle for The Lamb. But it was very strange knowing that I was going to leave and still be in the band.
The tour ended in France in May of 75. So too did Peter Gabriel's time with Genesis.
That I'd be the first one to go down.
The stunning news made headlines before the band could make a formal announcement.
One day we woke up and the front page of Melody Maker was Gabriel quits Genesis. Somehow the story had leaked. There would be obituaries in the music press. And people would sort of say, oh, no, that's the end of that.
The band's future was not assured by any means.
The remaining members of Genesis were faced with a daunting dilemma.
We desperately wanted to carry on, but we knew how difficult it would be because he'd become the focus of the band, the front man.
We all really thought it was the end of the band. It was like Jagger leaving the Stones.
A lot of people thought, that's it, there won't be any more. He was Genesis.
The misconception at that time was that Peter wrote everything and the band just played the music and that was it.
That's usually the misconception.
Determined to keep Genesis alive, Tony Banks, Mike Rutherford, Phil Collins, and Steve Hackett auditioned hundreds of new lead singers.
It was my job to teach these guys the tunes. I always did the harmonies, and so it was my job to teach these guys the melodies.
During the auditions, the band began to realize that the best new lead singer was already a member of the group.
The guys were saying, well, you know, you sound better than the guys who are auditioning. And I was saying, well, that's as may be, but I'm the drummer. I don't want to be the singer, you know, this is where I live.
With the tracks for their next album nearly finished, Genesis held a final audition.
We had the last hopeful down, and it didn't sound that great. And as he left, I said, can I have a go? You know, I know I could do better than this. You know, so I went down to the studio and I started singing the song. And everybody went, yeah, sounds great.
Gone were the towers you had known from a
Phil sang all the songs for A Trick of the Tail, but neither Collins nor his bandmates assumed he would be the permanent replacement.
We finished the record without a singer. I had just done the singing, but I was not the singer.
It was very difficult for us to visualize him as anything other than the drummer, you know, and he was also a background kind of guy. He was short. You know, he didn't look like the kind of guy you'd expect to see out the front of a group at all.
I got the job because we couldn't find anybody else, you know.
I like his sound of Phil Collins, though. He got something like something special about it, man. His voice, his vocal capability is different. It sets him apart. I think he sounds very unique. I feel like there's like, you know, even the testament to him being a drummer, coming into a lead singer role. Honestly, we know what happens after he leaves the band, right? And able to still find success in a solo career, that says a lot. It speaks volumes. It speaks volumes.
When A Trick of the Tail came out in the winter of 76, the enthusiasm of radio stations and record buyers made it triumphantly clear that Genesis would survive without Peter Gabriel. The album soared to number 3 on the UK album charts and nearly made the US top 30. Genesis launched a world tour in the spring with Phil Collins in the center spotlight.
The first show that I ever sang in was London, Ontario in Canada.
We go on stage and are they all going to go boo? But they loved it. The crowd loved it.
Because he'd come from inside the band. They didn't see it as sort of like an infiltrator. And he also was very good at it. He probably, dare I say it, was in some ways a better singer on stage live than Peter. Don't let Peter hear that.
In some ways he was a more natural singer than I was.
Diehard Genesis fans were divided by Gabriel's exit from the band.
I mean, the Genesis story is really in two parts, you know, Peter Gabriel and Phil Collins.
I'm sure that the old Genesis fans nightly stick pins in my effigy.
Phil Collins did a brilliant job, and in fact, the band took off to even greater commercial success.
Trick of the Tail sold more than all of the previous Genesis records combined. The band's success stirred mixed emotions in its most famous ex-member.
On the one hand, you're happy that the people you've known with since childhood did well, but my ego got twinged too, you know. So that went from a point, you know, when I was fronting the band, when everyone assumed that I did everything, to a point after I left the band and they got more successful, you know, when people assumed that I'd done nothing.
But by the fall of 77, Peter Gabriel had moved on to what would become an outstanding solo career. At the same time, Genesis guitarist Steve Hackett was also thinking about leaving the band.
I felt this sense of being an outsider from the word go.
He was writing a lot of music and it wasn't getting on the records because there was just no room.
2 years earlier, Hackett had laid down some of his musical ideas on his first solo album. And in the months that followed, Hackett became less and less interested in a future with Genesis. In November of 77, Genesis went into the studio to record their next album. Steve Hackett did not join them.
He never came in. He never came back. I was worried that if I saw them, they would convince me to stay.
With Steve Hackett gone, the band was now a trio. For Genesis, attrition had become routine.
As a three-piece, there was enough room, I think, for everybody.
In the spring of 78, Phil Collins, Mike Rutherford, and Tony Banks released the aptly titled And Then There Were Three.
Dang.
And three proved to be a magic number.
Bruh, for real. I always kind of talk and rant about bands having too many individuals. Five, dude. Four, yeah, man. Three, okay. You know what I'm saying? Is it really the magic number? I don't know. We'll see. But with that being said, hats off to these gentlemen, you know, being able to still maintain and say, hey, we still, and even the spin off on the album title with that, you know what I'm saying? So, I don't know, I respect it. You would think a band would crumble at that point. You went from like 5, 4 to 3 members. You'd think they'd be done, but they overcame in that sense, but to see what happens in the story.
On the strength of the hit single Follow You, Follow Me, the trio's album reached an appropriate number 3 in the UK. And by May, it was their first gold album in America.
I think what we do with Follow You, Follow Me, of course, being a love song, it kind of doubled our audience because suddenly there were girls in the audience, which there hadn't been before.
Genesis had come a long way from their early days as art rock cult favorites.
I don't know how many old Genesis fans there are of the early, early days, but, you know, a lot of it was, they've got a hit single now. Well, that's the end of that.
Well, what has happened is you've gone from being a cult to a big cult to being kind of more mass appeal.
Genesis launched World Tour 78 to support their newfound success. The tour continued for most of the year.
If we were going to really do this thing properly, we had to go to America and really play everywhere. And that meant time. And in fact, that's what caused my first marriage to break up.
During the course of the tour, Phil's wife left him and moved to Vancouver, Canada to be with her family. In a bid to save his marriage, Phil followed her. Before leaving, he made things clear to Mike Rutherford and Tony Banks.
I said, now I'm going to go and move to Vancouver. So if we can exist as a band with me living there and you living here, that's okay. But otherwise, I'm out. I'm out.
And I'm sure if we'd said, well, listen, man, it's the band or your missus, as happens sometimes in real life, he'd have said, well, to hell with you.
And they said, well, wait. You go ahead. You have a couple of months on your own, sort it out, and then we'll just get on. We'll do our solo albums, won't we?
For the first time since they started playing together 13 years earlier, Genesis was taking a break. January of 79 saw Mike Rutherford and Tony Banks working on solo projects, while Phil Collins worked on his marriage. Genesis faced an uncertain future. Coming up, success.
I'd never come.
When behind the music. While Phil Collins
Please
spent much of 1979 trying to pick up the pieces of his broken marriage, his Genesis bandmates, Mike Rutherford and Tony Banks, focused on recording projects of their own.
Phil was taking time off to try and sort out his marriage.
I went over to Vancouver and I stayed there for a couple of months, and it was obvious that things weren't going to work out any better than they were before. So I came back.
His marriage over, 29-year-old Phil returned to England in his empty house. It was there that he began doing something he thought he'd never do.
I'd written bits, but never written songs. And suddenly there was all this stuff that I kind of wanted to get out of me, I suppose. I can feel it coming in the air
tonight. Oh, Lord. That boy was in his zone.
I never intended it to be.
He was in his bag. Heartbreak do cause genius and creativity, you know what I'm saying? He said, man, I'm back on my bully. I'm back on my BS, baby. Uh-huh, boy, a beast was created that day.
Be a record. I just was writing songs, and then kind of, in a way, sort of stupid, childish way, I just thought, I'm not very good with words, and so I'll just send her these songs. Then she'll understand, you know? That was my feeling. That was what those songs were written for. They were messages. They were kind of letters.
When Genesis manager Tony Smith came by to visit, Phil played him home recordings of his new songs. The last
time we ever met. He said, these are great, you know, this could be a record.
Phil brought his homemade tapes to producer Hugh Padgham.
We listened to these songs and I just thought they were amazing.
Padgham agreed to help turn Phil's deeply personal tracks into an album.
We all knew what was going on, and the angst and heartache.
Phil also played his songs for Mike Rutherford and Tony Banks.
I was sort of surprised. He always had the side to him, which was sort of like his sort of James Taylor side.
I think I was probably jealous because he was able to write so much in the heart about his life and what was going on.
Don't get jealous, my boy.
Mike and Tony picked two of Phil's songs for the upcoming Genesis album. When it was released in March of 1980, Duke went all the way to number one in the UK.
Damn, he wrote a banger.
Phil Collins' songwriting talents were widely celebrated when Face Value, the collection of Phil's open musical letters to his wife, was released in 1981.
Phil's first album, solo album, Face Value, came out and just took off.
In the Air Tonight came out. And by 2 weeks, it was on number two in the charts, which was a bigger hit than we'd ever had, you know, as a group. So it was sort of a bit strange, really.
When In the Air Tonight hit the top 20 in America, Phil became a certified solo star.
I know, I thought, well, maybe he'd want to carry on just doing that, nothing else, which would have been perfectly understandable.
Mike and Tony realized that here was not only a great singer and a great drummer, but a great writer, too.
For the next 4 years, Phil kept up a successful solo career while collaborating with Mike and Tony on a series of top 10 Genesis albums. Some accused the former public school art rockers of selling out.
If you get too popular, then yes, you're going to be seen to sell out. But selling out to me implies doing something which you don't believe in, you know, and you're compromising in certain ways. I never did that.
The people that had Genesis,
facts.
The epic, in their mind, this was not what they wanted to hear.
In a highly successful musical balancing act, all three members of the band kept Genesis alive while continuing their solo pursuits. Rutherford's 1986 album, Mike and the Mechanics, went gold and spawned a top 10 U.S. single.
I'm always amazed more bands don't do what we did, which is to do different things and still run the group at the same time.
Genesis becomes something that we can't possibly do on our own. It gives the band a reason to exist. So it actually strengthened the band in some respects.
Genesis showed their strength as a group in the summer of 86 with the release of Invisible Touch. Entering the UK charts at number one, the album went to number three in America and sold over 5 million copies.
Peter Gabriel's number two, though. Damn.
By that fall, Genesis was playing the biggest stadiums in the world.
And I remember them doing three sold-out nights in Wembley Stadium. And you're talking 70 or 80,000 people a night. Well, I remember thinking, Jesus, this is big.
The band's Invisible Touch Tour played through the summer of 87, after which Genesis took a well-earned break. Tony, Mike, and Phil devoted most of the following 4 years to solo projects before making their next Genesis record. But the 1991 album, We Can't Dance, would be Phil Collins' last with the band. On March 28, 1996, Phil Collins publicly announced his departure from Genesis. For Phil, Mike, and Tony, it was the end of more than a quarter century of making music together.
Tony said, it's a sad day, but we're going to carry on.
Is that y'all think that's a vocal effect on Phil Collins' voice? Buddy, this voice is too clean, bro. Homie voice is just too raw. Like, does he have a vocal effect or not?
But it's a very sad day.
Coming up, Genesis
didn't want to
joy Genesis fans. Gabriel is lead singer of Genesis. Phil Collins left the band himself in 1996. Collins' exit left Genesis with just two original members. Mike Rutherford and Tony Banks had seen the band through all its changes and challenges, from its schoolboy origin to superstardom. Now Mike and Tony faced a difficult decision, to quit or carry on.
To be honest, I had quite a few doubts, actually, and I think if it had been just down to me, I might well have said, well, let's call it a day.
I'm not really sure what made us decide to give it a try, I suppose. Stubbornness.
So when they said they were going to carry on, I was really, really pleased, because I didn't really want to split it up. I just didn't want to be in it. But I don't think
that's really true. Genesis found a new voice with the addition of singer Ray Wilson, who sang the lead on the band's 1997 album, Calling All Stations.
Who was writing the music, though? So at this point, when Ray Wilson pops up, who's writing the music? Let me know if you know in the comment section below.
But the public reaction to the new Genesis lineup was extreme. They didn't seem to be ready for a Genesis without Phil Collins.
Phil was such a huge name and face. Losing that, it's always going to be hard anyway.
It allowed the band to breathe again, rather than being the focus being on Phil Collins, and I think that was healthy for Genesis, but the end result was going to be that they weren't going to sell as many records.
At the point before it came out, everyone said, oh, it's going to come in at number three or something. And I thought, well, okay, great, fantastic. And then it came in at number sort of 43, so we knew we were in trouble at that point.
They announced an American tour, but with hardly any airplay or chart success, found it hard to sell tickets.
We were down to play places in America, you know, 20,000 seaters, and we were selling 20 or 30 tickets.
The fans were staying home.
There wasn't enough support there.
Dang.
To really make it worthwhile, you know, so we cancelled it.
The lukewarm public reaction forced Mike and Tony into making one of the most difficult decisions of their careers. It was the end of Genesis.
We were getting older and just felt perhaps we didn't want to go through all that again, really, in a way, sort of, and all the knocks and everything, you know, that you have to put up with.
I haven't got the energy to go and do this again.
And Ray Wilson found himself without a band.
I know Ray was angry about it at the time, you know, because he felt, maybe rightly, that we hadn't given it enough of a shot.
It's a shame for Ray. I always feel bad about that, in a sense, because I think it was hard for him.
And he thought he could build on it. And, you know, he maybe he was right, maybe he wasn't. We'll never know.
Meanwhile, for Phil Collins, life was looking good. He married Orianne Seavey in 1999. Received a prestigious star on Hollywood Boulevard, and started working for Disney.
The Tarzan soundtrack.
Disney was part of my life. So for me, and especially having kids, when I was asked, it was a dream come true.
His first project was the animated feature film Tarzan, and one song was to bring him a trio of top awards.
We got the Grammy.
Thank you very much.
And the Golden Globe. And also the Oscars.
Very, very That's emotional. Crazy. Very emotional. Because I'm only a drummer, really.
Buddy put in work. Who would have thought, right? Who would have thought? That's crazy, bro. Just keep going. Drummer to lead singer to solo star to winning an Oscar, a Grammy, and a what? Emmy, is that what they said? Dang. Well, I recall very well when Tarzan came out, and, you know, hearing the soundtrack. It was just thorough all the way through. So hats off to Phil Collins for that.
And to get something like this was really, I hoped, but I didn't expect.
And then, of course, it then developed into a musical as well.
Which was probably the highlight of my musical life, really. Doing that on Broadway. Every day going to work, they'd say, we need a song, Phil. We need a song for this scene. It was fantastic.
Elated by his success and the birth of his son, Nicholas, Phil released a new solo album, Testify, which was once again a very personal record. Testify my
love for you. Those songs just came. Yeah, I mean, they just came. I was desperately happily married. Yes, this is a wake-up call.
I just felt rejuvenated, you know.
The birth of Matthew, his second child with Oriane, made Phil come to a major decision in his life, to stop his seemingly endless days of touring. He had been on the road for 30 years, and with young children, he decided that enough was enough.
I want to do the things that I hadn't been able to do with my older kids, and so I decided not to do anymore.
So in 2005, to say goodbye, he embarked on what would be his final solo tour. No, I can't stop loving you. It would be both physically and emotionally exhausting.
Ladies and gentlemen, I can't sing anymore.
During this tour, Phil's marriage started to break down, and Phil and Oriane announced they were separating.
I was going through an awful lot, having just got...
Tell me what's going on. The last tour, to wrap it up, to head home and kick it with the fam, that final tour ends up breaking the marriage.
Kids, my young kids, you know. Then suddenly it started to fall apart. My ex-wife and I still love each other, and I don't know why, but we got divorced.
But Phil was determined not to miss out on his kids growing up, so he stayed in Switzerland to be near them. Meanwhile, for Mike and the Mechanics, life was changing too. After the release of their album M6, Paul Young, their long-standing vocalist, died suddenly at home.
Paul Young was one of life's lovable characters, and Rose. He lived the rock and roll lifestyle, even when he went home. Very sad, I mean, such a young age, a fabulous voice, great talent, and a huge shock, really.
A further album and tour followed in 2004, but they found it hard to recapture their earlier success. Tony Banks in his solo career was to fulfill a lifetime ambition when he released his orchestral album, Seven.
Well, then a concerto?
I'm not sure I'll ever do any more music again. I had no idea. You know, I thought, well, before I give up, you know, I must just give this a go.
But Tony found the classical world far from rock and roll.
You feel a little bit inadequate in the classical world when you come from the rock world, I think. You're conscious of people thinking you're not a proper musician. So there's a bit of that you've got to get over.
But with no live performances, the album remained a critically acclaimed secret. A few years earlier, the original members of Genesis had met to promote the release of a series of box sets documenting their career. From this reunion, the seeds were sown for a possible tour of The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway with the classic Genesis lineup of Gabriel, Hackett, Rutherford, Banks, and Collins. A further meeting was set, but things didn't quite go to plan.
Anyway, when we got to the room, apart from it being great to be the five of us together again, it turned out that Pete still hadn't made up his mind.
I think he got slightly cold feet when he actually met with us and suddenly realised that he wouldn't be able to call the shots.
But when he left the room and Steve left the room, we kind of looked around at each other, me, Tony and Mike, and said, would you fancy doing the other lineup? Because, you know, we've got three of us here, do you want to do it?
The great thing about us always, you know, we did something so quickly, the three of us. So that was the decision, and we sort of put the idea in place.
And in 2006, delighted Genesis fans received news that Phil Collins was reuniting with Mike Rutherford and Tony Banks, and Genesis would tour again.
I think this one probably was the biggest, yeah. It certainly was ambitious. And certainly we spent a hell of a lot of money for 50 shows.
It was to be the most elaborate and expensive tour they had ever undertaken.
It was to be. When you start using them words, sound like something went wrong. It was going to be. It was set to happen, but...
Taken. With 190 trucks on the road and three full-time road and rigging crews, it was a comeback their fans would never forget.
It was easy to get up, easy to get down, providing it didn't rain.
But rain it did. Freak storms battered the shows, putting band, crew, and fans at risk.
In a situation like this, when we have lightning, first thing is everyone can
he's out of the rig, no questions asked, and everyone comes down.
What happens if it's lightning while we're on stage?
We're on stage, we have to leave.
You know, at one point it was just... Like it's all over the place. And I thought, we're going to be taken off any minute, no problem, you know. And they didn't take us off. They took the guys down who were doing the follow spots, you know, because anyone would get struck by lightning, but we were there. So you get these great shots of the lightning actually flashing behind the stage.
But come rain or shine, the fans couldn't get enough. And by the time the band got to Rome, there were 500,000 in the audience.
Show they've done, and I think they all were playing better than ever. Phil was singing better than ever. It was a great
500,000. That's a crowd, bro. That is a hell of a crowd.
Great show. I mean, I think it's very special.
It's a great thing to have in your collection of what you've done with your life.
The bond of friendship that held Genesis together for more than four decades still endures. And after their sellout reunion tour, the fans remain hopeful that the Genesis story isn't finished yet.
We always discussed the idea of writing some songs together. It was quite appealing, actually. The three of us, we love that. But then it's after that, what do you do with it? You know, an album is such a big commitment.
You don't really want to get into a room and suddenly find there's no magic there, you know. It'd be a bit depressing, wouldn't it, really? But it's more fun not to do it and think, well, there could be, if we did it, but we won't.
In the immediate future, I can't see it happening. If we still feel like it when my kids are driving, that'll be different.
Okay. There y'all have it. That's Genesis Behind the Music, man. Let me know y'all's thoughts on that one in the comment section below. Be sure to like, comment, subscribe, hit the notification bell. Follow me on Instagram, Twitter, Fort Worth Fabian. It's the road to 1,000,000, man. Peace, love, prosperity. Everybody takes time out to watch the videos, man. What y'all's thoughts on that one? A lot of story context to Phil Collins. You know, understanding Peter Gabriel, Genesis coming together and stuff like that. Interesting documentary, man. Let me know down below additional documentaries you guys want me to do reactions to. Behind the Music, whatever you guys want, man, put it in the comment section below. Be sure to check out the VH1 Behind the Music playlist, link provided in the description, as well as the comment section down below. Peace, love, man. We'll catch you guys in the next video. We out.